have made a positive difference in your life, and then try to be that for someone else. We can all make a difference. We can all touch somebody else. The worlds that we touch may not be the whole world, but you know what? To somebody, we may be their whole world, but just by what it is that we are in their presence, by what they are able to become because we touch them. So I want to dedicate this talk to dads everywhere who make a difference in the lives of their own children. And I think sometimes some dads are just really great. They make a difference in the lives of their children's friends, and they touch countless other lives because they inspire people with what real dads are and what a real dad can do and the difference that they can make. In point of fact, we all make a difference in the world, but there are those that make a truly lasting and profound difference. And I think that all parents make a profound difference in their children's lives, sometimes because of their presence and what they do for their children, and sometimes in spite of it, perhaps through their absence. You know, sometimes I hear people say, well, I don't like Mother's Day or Father's Day because my mother or father wasn't right or abandoned me or whatever. And I always think, you know what? Even in their abandoning you, they were giving you something you needed to have, whether you knew it or not, because all of us will bring forth things, sometimes because of the presence of the light, and sometimes we reach deep and something emerges from us because of its absence in our lives. So one way or another, and it's up to us to decide whether what our parents gave us was good or bad, as what we choose to become in life and the difference we choose to make in our own world, because we can all make a profound and positive difference. Sometimes I think we think, oh, I'm too small, I can't make a difference. And I'd like to just share with you the words of the Dalai Lama, who said, if you think you are too small to make a difference, try sleeping with a mosquito. Okay? Size doesn't matter, because you can make a really huge difference even if you're itty bitty and tiny, tiny in the world. You can make a difference just by who you are and how you are with the people around you. But speaking about Father's Day and parents, what is a parent's job actually? I think a parent's job is to teach our children the best that we can by providing an environment in which they can grow and fulfill their potential. Parents' job is not to make that happen, but to provide the atmosphere and the guidance to assist and allow the child to find it for themselves. Frank A. Clark said, the most important thing that parents can teach their children is how to get along without them. That's really, truly a successful parent. If you look around, it would be easy in our culture to come to the conclusion that a parent's job is to work hard and provide their offspring with all the comforts and toys available, to cater to their every whim, to chauffeur them everywhere they wish to go, whenever they wish to go there. In point of fact, the parent's job is simply to prepare their children to be able to fend for themselves, to stand on their own two feet, and to be able to assess whether a circumstance or a person is an opportunity or a danger and act accordingly. It is to be able to make their own way in the world and to be able to support themselves in a meaningful way. I really think that's when we have successfully launched our children, is when they can stand on their own, when they can think for themselves, when they can evaluate and critically think about the choices that they face and make a reasonable decision. I heard about two men who were having a conversation, and one says to the other one, has your son decided what he wants to be when he grows up? He asked his friend. He wants to be a garbage man, was the reply. Well, that's an unusual ambition at such a young age. Well, not really. He thinks the garbage men only work on Tuesdays. Our kids with stuff, but to enrich them in a way that serves them well, to teach them to set goals and work for what they want, to commiserate with them when they fail, and to celebrate with them when they are victorious, and to learn that both failure and success are part of life, and no one is immune to that, that we all stumble and fall, but it's to learn to pick ourselves up, dust ourselves off, and try again. Pat and Rob from a thing called Success Online write about being an effective parent, not just spoiling our children, but providing the correct environment. They write this: a favorite fish of many hobbyists is the Japanese carp, commonly known as koi. The fascinating thing about koi is that if you keep it in a small fish bowl, the koi will only grow to be 2 or 3 inches in length. Place it in a larger tank or a small pond, they'll reach 6 to 10 inches in length. However, when placed in a huge lake where they can really stretch out, it has the potential to reach sizes up to 3 feet in length. You probably already figured out that the simple point to this illustration is that the size of the koi is in direct relation to the size of the pond, and a comparable analogy can be made to children, that their growth is determined by the size of the pond that we provide for them to grow in. It isn't about giving them worldly dimensions that are large, but by giving them mental, emotional, and spiritual opportunities so that they can be exposed to different ideas, and so they can stretch and they can grow. You know, I love the thing about ideas. When you try on ideas, even foreign ideas or ideas that you might not necessarily agree with at first blush, when a mind stretches to think about something, it never goes back to the size that it was. I've had pants like that too that stretch out really bad. You can try them in the dryer and you're done for. But you know what? When it comes to a mind, that's a good thing. You want to stretch your mind. You want to challenge yourself. You want to try on concepts. That's what we're supposed to provide for our children. Not this sheltered environment with these preset ideas and belief systems. We're supposed to give them the ability to go beyond what our belief system is and to think for themselves and to try on new ideas and explore different avenues. I remember when my daughter was a teenager and I would take her friends someplace, she and her friends, they would be talking about things like spirituality or God or different things, and they would be asking all these questions, and I'd think to myself, when did we stop talking like that? When did we get all of our ideas just so-so and we never ask the questions anymore? What I think the grand thing is to not only encourage our children to explore, to ask questions, to try on new ideas, to do that with them, to listen to them, and to be keeping our minds open and stretched and inquiring and trying on new things. That's a parent's real job, is to create that environment and the guidance to grow to the full potential that they have, to really stretch beyond our boundaries and our borders and go to their own possibilities. We need to recognize and release our own divinity, not only help our children, but we do that by modeling that. Have you noticed you model things for your children? Do you remember when your kids were little and they'd say something funny, and it was usually something you had said? It just sounded funnier when it came from their mouth, because they're always watching and imitating and emulating what they see their parents do. I have to share about a grade school teacher who had a little contest with the kids, and she asked her students to describe what they liked best about their fathers. The winning entry read this way: I have so much fun with my father, I wish I had known him sooner. Every child, you, your children, your grandchildren, the children you'll never meet, every single one of us is born with a spark of divinity within us. And every one of us is special and unique and comes with our own purpose and our own destiny. A parent's job is to nurture that spark so that the child grows in a way that he or she is empowered to discover that within themselves and then live to that purpose. And it doesn't matter whether the child in question is a boy or a girl. There is a wonderful Swahili proverb that says, and leave this not long enough for everybody to write it down, the ladies anyway, the daughters of lions are lions too. The daughters of lions are lions too. We are all divinity. It doesn't matter whether we're male or female, we all have that spark of divinity within us. Children of ducks are ducklings. Therefore, children of God, which is what we are godlings. Okay, we're all godlings. There is greatness in all of us just waiting to be revealed, not just once, but over and over again throughout our lives. Our strength, Our greatness, our purpose lies in what we're naturally drawn to and naturally good at. Now, that doesn't mean that you don't have to work at it to increase it and to refine it, but that work we put into developing our natural gifts pays off in many different ways because we have a natural bent for it, because we're drawn to it. You know, I hear so many stories about kids who grew up and became lawyers or things like that because that's what their parents said they should become, when what they really wanted to be was an artist. And so they go out and have a successful career, maybe in law or engineering or whatever they do, being a doctor, and then they save enough money and then go what they've always wanted to do their whole lives was to paint or explore or be a fisherman or do the thing. What if we could allow our children the freedom to decide where they want to go rather than where we think they should go? Allow them to bring that godliness out from within them. How lions and lionesses learn to be lions and lionesses, how your dog learns to be a dog or your cat learns to be a cat, is they watch their parents and they imitate what their parents model for them. And what we need to be mindful of is our children learn the same way, and our grandchildren. They learn not by what we say, but what we do. They model ourselves. So if we want our children to continue to explore and to express and to bring out the greatness inside and to make a difference in the world, what do we need to be doing? The exact same thing. Continue to grow and explore and seek new ways to make a difference in the world. Once upon a time in our congregation, before we moved, we had a couple named Betty and Dan who have two grown daughters named Kim and Lisa. And I've shared about this before, but it's been a while. But for those of you who haven't heard this, it's a wonderful example of what we're talking about this morning in modeling for our children and being encouragement for our children. This begins with an email written by Kim, the eldest, in response to something particularly poignant that her dad, Dan, had written to her. Kim's response to that email is to both of her parents, Betty as well as Dan, so I'd like to read a short excerpt from that email because it so beautifully illustrates the profound and deep impact we can have on the lives of others, not least of which is our own children. We too often hear how parents impact kids in negative ways, so this is an example of the power of influence for good. She set the stage for this. I'll tell you that Kim is a pilot, and she's flown for several passenger airlines, but at this point in time, she was flying for a major delivery service worldwide. She writes, "Dear Mom and Dad, I am sitting here in the Alaska Airlines boardroom lounge overlooking various 747 cargo carriers, all lined up to take off and cross the Pacific Ocean on their way to Asia. Thanks to parents who told me that I could be anything in a time when women weren't pilots, told me I could be anything I wanted to be. I myself have lined up on runway 32 in Anchorage, fully loaded, pushed the power forward on the way to Asia. For that, I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart. I have been around the world several times now, and there isn't a captain I have flown with who hasn't heard about my mom and dad's influence and the impact of having positive parents." She ends with, "Your parents' voice is the one that stays with you your entire life. And once again, I thank you for being such a positive, supportive voice that always said, you can be anything you want to be. Thank you, Dan and Betty, for sharing this story with us, because nothing is more important than a true life story, especially from somebody that sat among us. We make a difference in the lives of our children. When we tell them that they can be anything and we really model that for them, we encourage them to fully fly and spread their wings and do exactly what we want to be." You know, so many times I have heard parents compliment their children, or one spouse compliment another spouse when that child or that spouse is not around, okay? But be very critical of that child when they're in their presence, almost like they have to be critical in order to impel the child or that other person to really reach for their greatness. And I always think, you know, compliment them twice as often as you criticize. It's very important that the people you know that you love, know that you love them and that you appreciate them and the good that you see in them, and especially our children. Some children wait their whole lives for a pat on the back from a parent to say, "Good job, You've done a great job. I love you. You can be anything. So if you take nothing away from today, if you have children, if you have grandchildren, please remind them that they are loved, that they are good, and that they are so capable. Find something to compliment them about rather than just finding fault with the things they do or don't do. Who we are makes a difference, not just with our children. You know, we think that our whole world is in our families, and it's not, because each of us interact every day with countless people. How many people you pass on the street, and every single person that you pass is an opportunity to make a difference. Every one of us has the power to do that countless ways every day. Leon Brown, a professional baseball player, an odd source for something totally metaphysical, said, "Never underestimate the valuable and important difference you make in every life you touch, for the impact you make today has a powerful, rippling effect on every tomorrow." Now, probably, and I don't want to underestimate anybody, but probably nobody in this room is going to bring world peace or end homelessness or feed all the hungry people on the planet. But that doesn't mean that we can't have that kind of a profound influence and effect on the people that we meet. You know, somebody that you pass with a warm look on their face, you might be the only person today who smiles and says good morning or says hello. In fact, when I walk, there are a couple grumpy people I've been passing for quite a while. The first of this year, I decided to make it my mission to smile, say hello, and get them to say hello back eventually. It's worked on every one but one. I'm still working on it. Because I think it's really important for us to never underestimate the power of a kind word or a smile or a difference that we might make in somebody else's life. You know, it's like holding a door for somebody with heavy packages, okay? You know who appreciates that more than anybody? You know who's gonna say thank you to you 100% is a man. If you see a man with heavy packages and you go and you open the door, they will always go, thank you. Sometimes women don't even acknowledge it because, you know, I guess we're so used to it. But men never fail to say thank you. So if you wanna have some delight, check that out as an experiment, see how that works. Or you're pulling into the parking space at a grocery store and somebody nearby is just finishing loading all of their groceries in their car. Well, just walk over and offer to wait for just a second and take their cart back and save them that trip. You're going in anyway, you're probably going to need a cart. It's just a little thing, but there are so many ways we can touch other lives in a positive and profound way, and never underestimate the power of what that might do in somebody else's life. For you, it may be just a moment, and for them, it could be the difference between finding the meaning and the purpose of going on in life because somebody noticed them and acknowledge them and knew that they're alive. We have the power to make such a profound difference in the lives of other people, but so often we miss that opportunity because we're in too much of a hurry. Rosa Parks didn't set out to become an icon of the civil rights movement. She was tired. She was sitting in that bus and she refused to give up that seat because she stood her ground, or in this case, sat her ground, because she was just too fatigued to give up her seat, and she became an icon in the civil rights movement. Such a little thing, such a profound difference. All of us have that power. Nobody may remember our name, but we can make a difference when we stay alert and awake and aware to the things around us. Here is a story of a woman who went a few moments of her day out of her way to make a difference in somebody else's life. It was just something she shared with some of her family and friends at Christmas time. This was written by a physician from the Metro Denver Hospice. Quote, "I had just one of the most amazing experiences of my life and I wanted to share with my family and dearest friends. I was driving home from a meeting this evening, about 5, stuck in traffic on Colorado Boulevard, and the car started to choke and to sputter to die. I barely managed to coast, cursing into a gas station, glad only that I would not be blocking traffic and would have a somewhat warm spot to wait for a tow truck. The engine wouldn't even turn over. Before I could make the call, I saw a woman walking out of the Quickie Mart building, and it looked like she had slipped on some ice and fell into a gas pump. So I got out to see if she was okay. When I got there, it looked like she'd become overcome by sobs, more so than that she had actually fallen. She was a young woman who looked very haggard, and the dark circles under her eyes were very deep. She dropped something as I helped her up, and I picked it up and gave it to her. It was a nickel. At that moment, everything came into focus for me. The crying woman, the ancient Suburban cramped full of stuff with three kids in the back, one of whom was in a car seat, and the gas pump reading $2.95. I asked if she was okay and needed help, and she just kept saying, "I don't want my kids to see me crying." And so we stood on the other side of the pump from the car. She said she was driving to California and that things were really hard for her right now. So I asked, "And were you praying?" That made her kind of back up for me just a little bit, but I assured her I was not a crazy person. And I said to her, "He heard you and he sent me." I took out my credit card and swiped it through the card reader on the pump so she could completely fill her car. And while it was fueling, I walked next door to McDonald's and bought two big bags full of food, some gift certificates for more, and a couple cups of coffee. She gave the food to the kids in the car who attacked it like hungry wolves, and we stood by the pump eating fries and talking a little. She told me her name and that she had lived in Kansas City. Her boyfriend left 2 months ago and she had not been able to make ends meet. She knew she wouldn't have the money to pay the rent on January the 1st, and so finally, in desperation, she had called her parents with whom she had not spoken in 5 years. They lived in California and said she could come live with them and try to get back onto her feet. So she packed everything up that she owned and put it in the car. She told the kids they were going to California for Christmas, but not they were going there to live. I gave her my gloves, a little hug, and said a quick prayer for her safety on the road. I was walking to my car, she said, "So are you an angel or something?" That definitely made me cry. I said, "Sweetie, at this time of year, the angels are really busy, so sometimes God uses regular people." The physician concludes the story this way. She says, "It was so incredible to be a part of someone else's miracle. And of course, you guessed it. When I got in my car, it started right away, and I got home with no problem. I'll put it in the shop tomorrow to check, but I suspect the mechanic won't find anything wrong. Sometimes angels fly close enough to you that you can hear the flutter of their wings. Don't wait for someone else to be an angel for you. Be the difference wherever you are, with whomever you encounter. Be the angel for someone else. When you see a need and you can, fill it. When you can offer a kind word of support, take the time to do so. See if you can see the extraordinary in the ordinary and bring it forth. If you're a parent, the difference you make in the life of your child is a lifetime far-reaching one and an opportunity not to be taken lightly. If you're not a parent, you can still make a difference in other people's lives." I'd like to conclude with just a little something I saw on Facebook yesterday, and I just thought it just filled the bill. The author is, of course, the famous or infamous unknown, and this is what they wrote. "If you planted hope today in a heart that felt alone, if you caused a laugh that chased the tears away, if someone's burden was made lighter because of your kindness, then your day was well spent. May all your days be well spent. Namaste."